Today we have one of the foremost linguistic experts on the Chamorro language. Dr. Sandra Chung is a distinguished professor emerita at the University of California, Santa Cruz. She received a PhD in linguistics from Harvard in 1976. After teaching for 11 years at UC San Diego, she moved to UC Santa Cruz, where she taught until 2017. At UC Santa Cruz, she also served as the chair of the Linguistics Department, chair of the Philosophy Department, and faculty assistant to the Executive Vice Chancellor. Dr. Chung is one of the foremost experts on the Chamorro language, with more than four decades of publications pertaining to the Chamorro language. Her research examines issues in theoretical syntax through the empirical lens of Chamorro and some other Austronesian languages. She has also done collaborative work in semantics and psycholinguistics. We have Dr. Sandra Chung, or as I will be calling throughout this interview or discussion, Sandy. Thank you for showing up, Sandy. How are you doing today?
I'm doing well, Pulan. Great to see you. Great to meet
you. All right. Same here. So, you know, just before we begin, you know, can you provide some background information about yourself just so us viewers could get to know you better? You know, for example, where were you born, raised, educated, and why did you decide to pursue a career in linguistics?
Well, I'm a Californian. I was born in the Bay Area in Berkeley, and I grew up in East Oakland and then in Berkeley. I am ethnically Chinese, but I think I'm a fifth generation American, although I do not really remember. My dad, who was born in Oregon, worked for the research arm of Shell Oil, first as a lab assistant and then as a research chemist. My mom was a housewife, although during the Second World War, she had been an executive assistant. They taught me to value education, and so to their dismay, I went east to be educated, to Harvard. They really hated that. But then I came back to California to teach. As for how I became a linguist, it was an accident. I went to college with a high school friend. We both were admitted at the same time, and he said, I think in my second year, he said he had just taken a linguistics course. He said, Sandy, you have to take this course. It was on historical linguistics, language change. I said, okay. Then the next semester, he came around again. He said, Sandy, you have to take this other linguistics course. Okay. And then I was hooked. I became a linguist. It was very interesting to me.
Oh, wow. So thank your friend for just saying that. Otherwise, we wouldn't have you here today. Thank you. How life works. If becoming a linguist was sort of a accident, how did you end up doing linguistic work about the Chamorro language? Where did you hear about the Marianas and so on?
That too was an accident. So this friend of mine, the second course, it was a really long time ago. And so the final paper was to write a grammar of a language. And he said to me, well, really, you need a language whose sound structure is very simple, so that you can get to its sentence structure. He said, choose Hawaiian. I said, okay. So I did that. And I wrote a grammar of Hawaiian, and then I was hooked. And I spent my graduate career working on Polynesian languages. I don't know if you know the some 30 Polynesian languages, they're very closely related to each other. And so you can't work on them without thinking about their history. So I thought about their history, but then after I began teaching, I began thinking that this work that I had done in historical linguistics was terrible. And I wanted to find a language that was still an Austronesian language, but not very closely related to other Austronesian languages. At the time, I was teaching in San Diego, and at the, it was called United States International University. At the time, there were students from every district in Micronesia, in the Trust Territory, including Palau and Northern Mariana Islands. And Palauan and Chamorro are both isolates within the Austronesian family, meaning that they're Austronesian languages, but no one knows their closest relatives. So I knew it would have to be one or the other of those languages, and there were speakers there. but Palauan has very challenging sound structure. So I found one of these students at USIU who was willing to work with me in my class. He is still my friend. I'm friends with his family. I watched his children and his grandchildren grow up. It's wonderful. And then I went to Saipan to work with him after he graduated one summer. It was fantastic. I never wanted to leave.
I heard you mention that Chamorro is an isolate in the Austronesian language family tree. Could you explain what exactly that means?
Well, language is an isolate. You don't know its closest relatives. So we know the closest relatives of English, right? And for the Polynesian languages, we know that Hawaiian and Tahitian are very closely related. But for both Chamorro and Palauan, no one knows what other languages they're most closely related to. And so there's a big fight, actually, for Chamorro about where exactly it fits in the Austronesian language family. All sorts of things have been proposed. Some people have proposed that it is grouped most closely with the Austronesian languages of Taiwan. Other people have proposed that it groups most closely with the Philippine languages. And other people have proposed still other things. It's not really knowable because of the absence of historical records. That is, you know, there is no Austronesian language with some shining exceptions, right? Most of the languages were unwritten before the Europeans arrived, right? Although not all of them. Yeah.
But you know what's interesting? I hear this common idea that Chamorro is just a Spanish language or a dialect or a Spanish-based creole. Is there any credence to that idea?
Okay, now I know that you have opinions on this, but so why don't you say what you think?
My view, again, I'm not an expert on linguistics, and I've only based this off of a couple of dozens of linguistic articles that I read, but based upon my understanding that Chamorro is not at all a Spanish-based creole, it's not a mixed language. Based upon the few studies that have been done in trying to formulate what constitutes a mixed language, you know, that the Chamorro language doesn't even fall close to that category. We don't see the major tenets of what we see in Creoles, simplification of grammar, many of the words just being based upon the prestige language, Spanish. And again, we don't see that reduction stage in grammar. And so it seems to me also that if we're going to base the standard of borrowed words or having grammatical elements, based upon another language that's been influenced, then we could seriously say that every single language in the world is a mixed form of that language. For example, Finnish, it was originally a VSO, syntactically speaking, but now it's a SVO. It's more of a SVO language, and that's due to the influence of Swedish and all these other languages. So we do see syntactic changes. We do see grammatical changes in other languages that are very drastic, much more drastic, I would say, than Chamorro, which has a lot of borrowed words. And there is some elements of Spanish grammar in the Chamorro, but it's really not that much, I would say, to say that all of a sudden it's a mixed or a creole. So enough about what I think. What about what you think, Sandy?
I completely agree with you, right? Creoles are generally simplified. Chamorro has a very complicated structure. Now, its phonology, its sound structure, while not as complicated as Palauan's, is pretty complicated. Its syntax is complicated in ways that we associate with other Austronesian languages. It just happens to have many words that were borrowed from Spanish. Now, if you think about it, English has many words that were borrowed from Norman French or from Latin or from Greek, right? And in fact, I think it's only like 36, less than 40% of the English vocabulary is Anglo-Saxon vocabulary, right? But no one says that English is a creole. No one says that English is a mixed language. Right? In the same way, Japanese has borrowed in the 6th century a lot of words from Chinese, right? In addition to borrowing some elements of the Chinese writing system, but no one says that Japanese is a creole or a mixed language. It irritates me actually when this comes up and I give papers and people see the words visita, you know, visit, or I don't know, careta, car, right? And they'll say, oh, is this a creole? No, it's a language. In a way, every mature language has borrowed words from other languages.
Exactly. You are exactly on the point. And in that one video I made exactly that same point you made, which is, yeah, when you look at the other examples like Japanese, Korean, and again, there's different, of course, variations of those, but you know, in general, the standardized versions, they contain more than 70%, again, based upon dictionary derived percentages. 70% could be traced back to China, so of their vocabulary. And you know, at that one study by Rodriguez Ponga, you know, which said that about 53% of the vocabulary from Chamorro, again, this is dictionary based percentages, are Spanish. So exactly as you said, you know, there's a lot of borrowed words that are in these other languages, yet no one goes and says, hey, Japanese must be a creole, or the English language must be a creole, even though the English language being a creole or some type of mixed language probably has much more weight than saying Chamorro is. And so this brings up another question, which is, based upon your vast studies of the Chamorro language, what are unique features of the grammar, of the syntax, of the Chamorro language that most other Austronesian languages do not share?
When I think about what makes Chamorro unique among other Austronesian languages, one is that it has a bunch of rules or constraints that sort of shape how ideas are expressed in sentences so that the subject is salient. So in Chamorro, for instance, you can have a pronoun direct object if the subject is a pronoun too, but not if the subject is a non-pronoun, a full noun phrase. You can say uliho, I saw you, right? Or ukentutusiho, I'm speaking to you. But if you're going to say Joe is speaking to you, you wouldn't say akentutusiho si Joe. You'd say kinentutusiho as Joe. In the same way, you can say the kids wash themselves, right? But you'd never say the kids wash the car. You'd never say it that way. You'd say you'd use the passive. So another way of putting it is, Chamorro, there are certain kinds of subject and object combinations where the Chamorro language doesn't want them to be expressed as such. Some other construction must be used, the passive. That's one thing. Another thing that makes Chamorro special is that it has infinitives, but it doesn't have to use them. So if you want to say in Chamorro, I tried to win the prize, you can say, I tried to win the prize using the infinitive to win, guman utsagi gumana I premio. Or you can say, I tried that I would win the prize. Utsagi paru gunna I premio. You don't have to, you have the infinitives, but you don't have to use it. And most languages, either they have infinitives and use them, or else they don't have infinitives at all. So it's kind of a wealth of riches in the Chamorro language.
Wow, thank you for that. And this brings up something else, which is, you recently published in 2020 a wonderful book, you know, Chamorro Grammar. And you know, many Chamorros have been using the publication by Donald Topping, linguist Donald Topping, that Chamorro Grammar, you know, in 1973, which was published. So how exactly does your 2020 publication, and your understanding of the language, how does it differ from Donald Topping's 1973 Chamorro Grammar publication?
That's a really good question. See, the audience is different, the time is different, and Don's and my linguistic expertise are different, yeah, our expertises. So Topping and Dunca's audience was high school students. They wanted to produce a grammar for that high school students, Chamorro speaking high school students could use to learn the structure of their language. And that was the whole point of that whole series of grammars, the Pali language series, which produced grammars and dictionaries for Chamorro, Palawan, Walayan, and so on and so forth. And at that time, when Don and Brandita wrote that book, there still were a lot of high school students who spoke Chamorro, right? Now time has passed. Far fewer younger people speak Chamorro. And the question arises of whether Chamorro is an endangered language. So I wanted to write a grammar that addressed a broader audience that would help people to maintain and keep alive and even revive the language. We have to honestly think about the possible future in which fewer and fewer people speak Chamorro. Don, so those are differences, right? Don was also, he was trained as an American structuralist, which means the style of linguistics that he practiced believed that every language was unique and not necessarily the same in any way as any other language. There were no commonalities, right? Whereas I was trained as a Chomskyan linguist, a generative linguist. So I was trained to believe that there is a lot that all languages share, even if they differ in many ways. And that you can see that informs our work. So toppings parts of speech are very Chamorro specific, whereas I tried to use nouns, verbs, and adjectives in my grammar. That's one example of it. Now, here's another difference. Topping was the first professional linguist to work in a serious way on Chamorro, right? Most of the people who came before him were self-trained, self-taught linguists. But he was professionally trained, and he was the very first, right? And he was also the first to work with native speakers of Chamorro and co-author with them, right? Because I came later, I had the benefit of his work, and I really benefited.
So he was literally the first trained professional, not unlike, like Stafford or these other people who were just, based self-trained, as you mentioned. So that is a very interesting thing. So you met Donald Topping before, and
I met him briefly when I was a graduate student. Remember I told you I was working on Polynesian languages. I passed through Honolulu a couple of times.
Yes.
And that was right around the time when he was working on this ground, actually.
Oh, wow.
But since I didn't know anything about Chamorro, right, and he was also an administrator, a very skilled administrator who got the big grants that funded all these grammars and dictionaries, I think we may have, briefly talked. did you know that he was also an accomplished, I think, long wave surfer?
No, I did not know that at all. Wow.
Yeah, his obituary, which was published in the journal Oceanic Linguistics and is freely available online, is totally worth reading.
So just based upon your studies on the Chamorro language and your observations of it, for the past few decades, you may have noticed that the Chamorro language is changing over time, so like, for example, do you notice that older speakers speak differently than younger speakers? Do you see the influence of English? How would you see that affecting the language? So what changes are you seeing in the language over time?
The principal change is that the younger generation mostly isn't speaking Chamorro anymore. Now, using English words, if you think about it, back until the 17th century, right? Like from maybe 1680 until the present time, speakers of Chamorro have always been bilingual in something. The only question is what that other thing was and how fluent they were in the other language. Sometimes it was Spanish, sometimes it was Japanese, might have briefly been German, then it was English, right? So I think that, the Chamorro language does a very good job of assimilating foreign words into its vocabulary. Right. That's why some words that you have to know that Guelu and Guela are from Abuelo and Abuela, right? Grandfather and grandmother's like, oh my God, that's borrowed. Or you have to know that carne, meat, is borrowed from carne. There, it takes some skill to recognize some of these words as borrowed. Borrowings have changed, but I think people probably always switched. They did code switching. You know, they move from language to language, and fluent speakers still do that today, right? They move from English to Chamorro. Sometimes in the middle of a sentence, right? And that's perfectly coherent. It makes perfect sense. People do it all around the world, right? Whenever in these multilingual situations, all the time. And it's one of the ways that you can see that a language is alive. I mean, one of the ways that you can see that a language might not be as alive anymore is that people don't speak it, or you find people who can understand everything but not speak. Right? This is how I before I was five, I used to understand Cantonese but not speak. Then I went to elementary school. Man, it disappeared. It's. But what do you think? How in your estimation has the Chamorro language changed?
And correct me if I'm wrong, if anything I'm about to say. So I complete. You know, I agree with what you were saying. There is that. First of all, you know, young Chamorros are not even speaking the language. You know, the surveys I did, and also collaborated with the, you know, the study by Michael Bivakwa, you know, showed that less than 5% of young Chamorros, you know, less than 31 years old, could even hold a basic conversation in Chamorro. And that's very, very, very scary to think about. And Fishman, linguist Fishman, you know, he said that what constitutes an endangered language is not necessarily the amount of speakers speaking the language, but whether it's being transmitted at all. So while we still do have thousands of speakers today, the issue is that, you know, they're all, you know, mostly older speakers, you know, and so that are not necessarily passing down the language. And also, you know, what we see, you know, at least what I'm observing is that based upon a new generation of speakers who are learning the language as a second language, as a heritage language. And so, you know, which is different, you know, different from growing up with it and so on. And so, interestingly, you know, I see a lot of the influence of the syntax of English on second language learners, where, you know, for example, instead of, you know, saying a sentence in a VSO way, you know, for example, Hali'i si John ikareta, they just say, you know, si John Hali'i ikareta, you know, for example, which fits with more with the English syntax. So I see that influence of the English language, you know, amongst the new generation of speakers who are learning it as a second language. I also see the interesting way politics, you know, particularly, you know, the type of indigenous nationalism that we see and how that affects the language, where, for example, you know, we see Chamorros, and this is particularly to the new generation of speakers, are deliberately trying to not use, you know, borrowed, you know, so-called borrowed Spanish words or borrowed English words, and instead are trying to use what they would refer to as the more antiguo words. For example, instead of saying familia, you would say mangafa, or instead of saying seduce maasi, you would say sina maasi. So, and these things I see reflect this nationalist movement that is emerging amongst the Chamorro people. So that's also a very interesting thing I see second language learners are, and the changes that we're seeing in the language, you know, how the politics affects it. And I hope as you hope as well that you know, that the language, you know, continues on, you know, even though we have less than 5% who are, and again, this is surveys based on Guam, so I can't speak for the CNMI, are able to learn and perpetuate the language.
It's very, these drives to, the kind of drive to use indigenous-only words is a very interesting drive, you know, because, you know, you see it a lot, I think, both in languages that are endangered, but also there are just some languages where, hey, that's how they do it, like German, you know? It's just, we'll just make up this compound word. We don't need to borrow. Although even German now borrows increasingly from English. I don't know, because borrowing is so deeply woven into the fabric of the Chamorro lexicon, that is the vocabulary. It might be difficult to get rid of all of it, especially since it's not always that recognizable, you know? I have to say, I don't know if you have seen, there is this odd little movement to use only Anglo-Saxon words in English.
Yes, I've heard about that.
Yeah, and so if you go to the English website, you think, and there are some displays of what this would be like, and it's just, it's not English as we know it. You know, I mean, I think that, well, the drive to, you could call it purify, you know, a language so that only the indigenous words are left, strengthen the indigenous culture, is a very understandable move. But
it is interesting, like when you mentioned that, you know, how the English language and that movement or French movement or whatever you want to call it, trying to purify it. For example, I read that like the word umbrella, you know, from, you know, Italian and so on, you know, they, instead of saying umbrella, they would say rain shade, you know, trying to use only the Germanic, you know, origins of the word. So that is interesting. And yes, it is, as you point out, you know, how there's this purification of the Chamorro language going on, and, you know, amongst other nationalistic groups around the world where they're trying to strengthen a type of nation identity, a cultural identity. So while, you know, I wouldn't personally say that it's effective in terms of trying to connect with, especially with older speakers who when I was trying to use all these Antigua words like mangafa, you know, and so on, my grandma was like, no, what is that? You know, she didn't understand it. And, you know, and at the time I was still learning the language, so I didn't understand what I was doing too. I was like, I thought that meant family. She's like, no, to say family, it's familia. So it's very interesting, you know, the different ideologies that are coming from the language movements, and especially in terms of standardizing the language, which I know you are a consultant and involved in the CNMI. So what are some challenges and that you faced and that you observed in the standardization of the orthography in the CNMI?
Well, you know, okay, let's talk a little linguistics, okay? The Guam orthography and the CNMI orthography are examples of two classic solutions to a hard problem. And the hard problem is, how do you spell a language, right? Usually, if you're gonna devise a spelling system, the best spelling system will satisfy two goals. The first is, for every distinctive sound is represented just one way. So if there's a K sound, you're gonna use one letter for it. It's probably gonna be the letter K, but, you know, and so on and so forth. We call that one sound, one symbol. The other goal is you want to spell the word the same way in every single one of its different forms. That's known as one word, one spelling. Now, there are a lot of languages where you can satisfy both goals at once, but there are some very interesting languages, in fact, arguably quite a few of them, where not both goals can be satisfied at the same time. English is such a language. That explains why English has the spelling system it does, a spelling system where the sound and the symbols correlate very poorly, right? So think of tough, through, right? Though, right? All spelled with O-U-G-H, right? Okay, Chamorro is another such language. So just think about tati, which means behind, back, right? Like, in back of, tati, right? If you want to say in back of me, you say gitateku. That's why in the Guam orthography, tati is spelled T-A, funna, T-T-E. Because that last vowel sounds like A sometimes, a letter E, and sounds like E other times. But if you want to spell the word the same way in all its different forms, you would just choose one of those vowels. That's what, so, and the Guam orthography chose E. Now, the CNMI 2010 orthography, which is historically descended from the Guam orthography, right? And they all go back to 1973, the Marianas Orthography Committee, where Don Topping was a consultant. In the CNMI, what happened in 2009 was a bunch of people got together because they were so frustrated with earlier orthography, because it's really hard to use if you don't understand the principle. And then even if you understand the principle, it's still hard to use. Like, who would ever guess that Hamza was spelled with an O at the end? Know what I mean? Yeah. And so they thought about it and decided to prioritize the other goal and to spell the words the way they sound, even if it means they're spelled differently sometimes in their different forms. So in the CNMI orthography, tati is spelled T-A-L-O-N-A-T-T-I, but in tateku, it's T-A-T-T-E-K-K-U, right? So the vowel changes. It's a trade-off. You can't, because the Chamorro sound structure is so intricate and so interesting, you just can't satisfy both goals at once. So it was just a choice that they made. I think that, and what has turned out, if I understand correctly, is two things. First, because of bilingual education has come back in the CNMI public school system, and many of the children are not Chamorro speakers, that they might not even be ethnically Chamorro. The CNMI orthography is really easy for them to learn because it's spelled the way it sounds. At the same time, many older speakers who, or not many, but some older speakers in the CNMI who had learned the older system don't want to change, because for them, the older system is, that's their language. That's their written language. That's how they learn to spell. And so really both systems are being juggled. Now, as standardization is a different issue, right? In a really interesting way, English was not standardized, at the time of Shakespeare. It's like words were not always spelled consistently or the same way. Standardization is a sociolinguistic phenomenon that, can arrive at certain points. You could imagine a world in which there was no standard orthography. And in fact, we have that world for Chamorro now. You can use the CNMI orthography, the Guam orthography, or you can use an orthography that's not standardized, which is what the traditional Catholic Church's orthography was, or the Spanish orthography, which the Catholic orthography is descended from. It's like, as long as people know what the words are, it's not really a problem. The problem comes when you lose that base of native speakers and you're dealing with people who are learners or heritage speakers, and the proliferation of spelling systems is not helpful. Actually, in an amusing way, it's also not helpful to linguists who are interested in learning a little bit of Chamorro very fast, because most of those linguists assume there's only one orthography, as it spells the sounds the way they actually sound, which is, in terms of the published literature, that's absolutely untrue. A unified orthography would be wonderful, and that's actually, sociopolitically, that's the only way to go, right? Before 2010, there was a unified orthography. It was Topping's orthography with minor adjustments, right? So it took a lot, I think, of frustration for the educators in the CNMI to change their position. I actually thought going into that series of meetings that, you know, because I told you, two goals, right? Can't satisfy both at once. But, you know, as long as you satisfy one, it's fine. And so I convinced myself that maybe the best way to do, the best thing to do might be not to change anything. But man, everyone else felt something really different. It was fascinating. It was really fascinating.
And from your experiences there, you know, just so I could hear the, we could hear the inside scoop, what exactly was going on with the, was there tension between the Guam delegation and the CNMI delegation concerning the, you know, trying to come up with a standard orthography? Why didn't Guam also follow through with that orthography and so on?
That's a good question. Now, I learned recently in the last year or two that I think it's the charter for the Guam Language Commission declares that they should consult periodically with their counterparts in the NMI. But in fact, my understanding is that there hasn't been much consultation in recent years. So even though both units had orthographies that are descended from the 1973 orthography that Topping was the consultant on, as they revised them, what happened was there wasn't a whole lot of consultation. So Guam was the first to introduce the law nut. I can't remember exactly when that happened. Then the CNMI followed, right? And there were other adjustments like that, where first Guam would do something, then the CNMI would follow. I don't actually know, because the meetings were put together by the CHamorro Carolinian Language Policy Commission in the NMI. I don't actually know whether there even was outreach to Guam. There might not have been. I'm just clueless, because all I did was show up. You know, I mean, it was actually wonderful for me, because, you know, you mentioned how long a time I had spent working on CHamorro. Well, during most of that time, most people would not speak to me in CHamorro. And the reason was because their English was so much more fluid than my CHamorro. I mean, at the beginning, the only people who would speak to me were 5 years old and under in CHamorro. And I was fortunate that there were enough of them around that I could speak CHamorro with that population. You know, that was great. And so this set of meetings I went to was not the first set of meetings, but it was among the first set of meetings that were conducted entirely in CHamorro, and I had to sit there for 3 days. It was mind expanding, you know? I mean, it took so much mental effort to kind of key in at every point. And then at certain points, I was called upon to say something. Now, sometimes I would just have to default to English. Other times I tried to speak in CHamorro, and that was an enormous effort too. I mean, I know from your Turkey Panini video, how, let me tell you, I've been there too. It's so stressful, right? But it was fantastic. It really, from that experience, that experience and the other experiences working with the dictionary project, I really acquired a fluency in CHamorro that I would never have been able to acquire, because I'm an outsider, and I wants to speak CHamorro to her. It's like...
But malagutu kumwen tu tiyagi kinu CHamorro.
What?
And speaking also of the orthography and the, you know, the attempt to standardization, here's a thing I've always wanted to ask you, which is, what is the deal with the spelling, the different spellings of CHamorro? We have the CNMI, and yes, I know, the CNMI has the so-called more traditional way of spelling it, while you know, the orthography, the commission orthography on Guam, you know, in 2017, you know, it was passed where you capitalize the CH, and they justified it because it's one letter. Is that a, based upon, you know, your school of thought deriving from the generative grammar and or whatever in your knowledge of orthographies, is that a common thing to do for for other languages to capitalize a two letters if they represent one sound, or is that just a new thing?
That's a really good question, and it's really good that you asked that. Mostly, capitalization was really developed, the difference between capital letters and small letters is really developed around the as a printing device, right? I mean, in classical languages, when you look at Latin inscriptions from the Roman Empire, they're all in capital letters, and there's no word separation, for instance. So the difference between capital, uppercase and lowercase letters came in with printing, and because it's a printing device to signal the beginning of a sentence, whereas the period or other punctuation signals the end, right? It really only affects print units, and a letter is a print unit. Okay, the vast majority of languages, if they have a sound that's represented by two letters, will capitalize only the first of those two letters if the word begins a sentence. Think of English, English is like that, right? In Catholic Church, if you're going to capitalize both words, it's only the C in both, even though the ch of church is one sound, just like the ts of tamil. Still, there are very, very few languages that usually for just one of the sounds that's represented by two letters choose to capitalize both. So I believe in Dutch, the there's a vowel, I don't know what it is exactly, that's represented with two letters, I, J. And so both of them are capitalized. And the rationale is that, they're both really skinny letters. So you capitalize both, it looks bigger. I think Czech also might capitalize both. They're called digraphs, I think. Yeah, might capitalize both letters for one thing, but only in acronyms. So it's what you could call a minority position. As a linguist, I need to say that the idea that this move is linguistically motivated is it's a little dubious, I'll say that with a smile. Sociopolitically and sociolinguistically, it's perfectly acceptable, and there are one or two examples where it happens. It's no accident that the Guam orthography also made this decision for. It made this decision for every word, not just CHamoru, that begins with ts, right? And it also made it for ng, which is represented with the two letters ng. But no one ever talks about those, No one ever talks about what would happen if the word for duck came at the beginning of the sentence, or the word for ngingi, right? So, but supposedly you capitalize the n and the g, and I've seen that too. But what upsets or activates, what drives people's strong emotions about this is the word CHamoru, because it's a very potent word from the standpoint of the culture. In the same way, maybe you have heard of or remember the controversies over how to spell the word, the final vowel, the word for God, right? It's because that's another potent word. It's like, there are lots of words we could talk about that have that spelling, but they aren't powerful words from the standpoint of the culture. And so when a linguist sees, when a linguist like me, who am not a sociolinguist, I'm a theoretical linguist, I see these controversies and I think, this says something to do with language, culture, and society, not my area. So I respect all of the decisions that have been made. Of course, you have to choose. It's like, are you going to capitalize that H or not?
Got you. And not to put you on the spot, but would you capitalize the CH? Not?
No, I would not. But that's because you have to be consistent, right? And I don't, Now you know that I wrote to you a little bit in the Guam orthography, but that orthography, to be honest, is difficult for me to use reliably, even though I'm a linguist. So because I use the CNMI orthography, I have to use the CNMI spelling. In my academic writings before 2010, I used to use this orthography, which is neither the Guam orthography or the CNMI orthography. And that's, why did I do that? It's because of, in an annoying way, many linguists assume that the spelling is the pronunciation if a language is sufficiently unknown to them. And so I had to try to create a system that was normalized, you know, that that would work for them. But now that the CNMI orthography exists, I use that.
So what are examples of Chamorro or Chamorro dialectical differences that we see between the islands, like, you know, like Rota and Guam or Saipan, and between just the villages that you observe and see?
Well, okay, you mentioned Rota, right? Everyone knows that Rota has different sound structure, and that's cool, right? So, and how is it different? Well, there are no double consonants. They lost all those double consonants. Which is why, you know, in Guam or Saipan, the way you'd say what I love, right? Guinai zaku, right? And Rota, guinai zau, right? There's no KK, right? Just the H. And then the two low vowels, the A and the A, they are mostly merged. So in Rota you say paku for now, not paku. But not all of those vowels have gone away. And that's very difficult for someone like me who's an outsider. So Papadza still has the back A. But Hano has the front A. So someone should really document in detail which of those vowels still remains the back low vowel for Rota. Then of course there are differences in word choice, right? So my belief is that in Guam, for car, you could say careta or tumobit, maybe. And in Saipan, you would never say tumobit. But it's just not true, right? I've been told that in Guam, the word for hose, like garden hose, is tilipas. It's the same as the word for intestines. That's not true. In Saipan, the word is hose. It's borrowed. They're both borrowings, right? Just from different languages. In Saipan, mosquito coil is senko. It's borrowed from Japanese, but I think it's odu in Guam. I've heard it's like manyaga for, you know, they stayed in Luta, but I've also heard mansaga. Whereas in Guam, I think you would only say manyaga.
Will the standardization, you think, will that, you know, totally erase those differences?
You know, it's a question whether they'll be erased by standardization or language endangerment. I mean, already because of television, you know, people in Rota hear the variety of Chamorro that is common to Saipan in the north of Guam all the time. You know, I can remember when I first started going to Saipan in the late 70s. The only television that you could watch was yesterday's LA TV, literally. You know, it would be shipped in, you know, on a, because this was before computers too, right? So there was no digitization. They would come in on a, you know, and then they'd show it. It was yesterday's television from Los Angeles or whatever. They'd show it in Saipan the day after. But now there are all these local shows, right? People hear what you could call the Guam Saipan standard all the time.
So besides, you know, different words, that different word usages and, you know, different phonetics and pronunciations, do you also see differences in in the syntax or in other grammatical features that you see in the, you know, between Saipan, Guam, and Rotatinian?
Little differences, but they are very little differences. Like there's some differences in the ways you mark case, right? Like in, I think in Guam, you'd say, say you were saying, you were seen by John. Let's just focus on by John. You'd say, Aswan, right? But in Saipan, you could say Aswan or Kiaswan. It's like that. Or in Guam, you would say, if you said, when are you leaving, right? A question that always used to stump me because I would arrive on the island and the first thing people would come up to me and they'd say, when are you leaving? And Shmuel, I'd say, why are you asking me when I'm leaving? That's what I think. Why don't you ask me how long I'm staying? You want me to leave? And then I just forget how to answer. It was, you know. And then I learned that people, when they said those words, they were really asking, how long are you staying? But it was just very hard for me to respond. Anyway, if you're going to say that in Guam, you'd say, ngai an na paronhano, right? In Saipan, ngai an ni paronhano. So it's the difference between na and ni, another little word, grammatical, a functional word, right? There are those kinds of differences.
Got you. And you know, based upon your, you know, again, your long decades of studying the Chamorro language and how has your studies, you know, contributed to the broader field of linguistics?
Well, in a couple of ways. You know, I mostly study sentence structure. I think the work that I have done on Chamorro has helped to convince people that even though many languages put the verb first in the sentence, different languages have different ways of producing that word order. So the way that word order is produced in Chamorro is different from the way it's produced in Irish. Okay. The work that I have done on questions, you know, in a question like, who do you think you saw? Or, you know, what do you think I should order? Right? The question word can be very, very far from the verb that it's associated with. And so the work that I did on Chamorro agreement helped provide a new kind of evidence that very long distance between the question word and its verb is created by a series of short steps of movement, not just one long movement, but several short movements. And then the work that I have done with my colleague Matt Wagers on psycholinguistics, which has been really exciting, I think demonstrated what could be, that it really is possible to do behavioral experiments on how people actually understand language and time that aren't done in the laboratory with university students. They can be done in the community on a relatively understudied language with people who range from like 18 to 80, you know, years old. So it is possible to bring this style of research into the community. And that's been pretty exciting.
And what are your current projects and studies, you know, right now and as for the future?
Oh, thank you for asking. I think Matt and I are writing up the most recent experiment that we did on reflexives in Saipan and Rota, right? We would love to come back to the Mariana Islands to do more experimental work after COVID is over. I'm also still working with the NMI community on their dictionary project. So that's a long-term commitment.
If you liked and enjoyed the video, consider supporting me on Patreon so I can continue to produce more Pacific Studies content. Like this video, subscribe to the channel, turn on all notifications, follow me on social media at PulanSpeaks, and a special seduce masi to Patreon supporters Buti Un, Pim Lim Tiako, and Dylan Simblon.
Sidzu Samasi for watching. Guahusi Pulen, and Pulen has spoken. Esta.